I'd rather be perceived as desirable because I am open. I can communicate. I can be expressive. I'm not afraid of talking about my feelings and important things. I think I'd feel way more comfortable if I was portrayed as desirable because of those things, as opposed to here's a guy who's got, you know, like short hair, white teeth, and is clean shaven.
You're watching Tough Talk, a series where we explore men's stories of facing challenges and finding the upward spiral. Today, I'm joined by New Zealand's Bachelor star, Zac Franich. Zac and I are actually old school mates, and he reached out to me on social media because he has a passion to raise awareness about suicide and to get men to speak up about their mental health. Welcome to Tough Talk, going deeper. Together, we're exploring what's going on behind the high rates of male suicide and violence in New Zealand. I'll be talking to Kiwis who are tough enough to show their emotions, so we can all learn how to talk about what's going on deep down. So Zac, tell me a little bit about yourself.
Where do I start? I spent a large part of my life trying to qualify for Olympics, and that was really my main focus. And in 2015, I had to go through a really messy and quite a lengthy selection dispute, which ended up in the High Court. And for me, that brought up a lot of my insecurities about not being good enough. It kind of kicked me off on a bit of a downward spiral to my first quite traumatic experience with my own mental health.
You're a guy that people probably see as quite successful because you've been on TV.
Yeah, it's funny, eh? Like, you go on a TV show and you're somehow, people think that you're a success, when in reality it's just kind of right place, right time, an opportunity comes across you, and the kind of person I am, I like to take those opportunities. Back to that experience in 2015, when I went through that first real life event, I think things like that put me in really good stead to be able to take on challenges and experiences, like going on something like The Bachelor.
So I wonder if you could tell us a little bit about what you're experiencing in terms of your mental health during that time when your self-worth was really challenged.
I was selected as part of a two-person crew to race at a World Champs that year. And the person I was selected with didn't feel I was good enough. Felt I was too old, too slow, too weak, and just not a good enough person for them to race with. Which, you know, when you train your whole life and you finally get your opportunity and you fought really hard for your opportunity and you deserve that, to hear those sorts of things come back from a peer is quite challenging. And then for them to have enough will to, and for them to believe so strongly in your inability to take that to the High Court, which I think is only the second case in New Zealand sporting or New Zealand history where a sports case has actually gone to the High Court. That's quite challenging. Unbeknownst to me at the time, it really kind of set in motion quite a slow gradual decline to depression for me. In the end, we ended up resolving the issue pretty hastily, and we ended up racing together. But in order for me to do that, I had to bottle up all those feelings of, just not being good enough and everything that went with it. I had to bottle it up, put a lid on the jar, throw it in my backpack, because for me, getting a chance to realise my dream and race at a world champs for my country was something that I didn't want to lose through someone else's actions. What I didn't understand, or what I didn't quite comprehend at the time, was that when I got home and when it was time to unpack all those feelings, how much stuff came out of that jar.
Mm.
You know, to a point where it's something I'm still dealing with it right now. Like if I see that person in the street, I get really anxious, and I just avoid interacting with them.
Mm.
It was an experience where I gained a lot of awareness around what I was feeling, and I actually realized that I'd been white knuckling, you know, like just gripping onto the steering wheel, just kind of white knuckling it for longer than I thought.
Mm.
And there's something really liberating around just letting go and just talking. I probably went on a downward spiral for about, you know, 12 months after, 12 to 15 months after that whole incident occurred. And I just got to a point where I was miserable. Things which I used to enjoy doing, like exercising, like training, being physically active, made me anxious. I just didn't want to go anywhere near it. Like I wasn't getting out of bed until about 11:30 in the morning, and someone who's been out of bed at, you know, 5:30, 6 a.m. for more than half my life, training in the mornings and being active, that was when alarm bells started to kind of ring. And I was talking to a friend, and they were like, "I think you're depressed."
Mm.
And I was like, "No, I'm not depressed." Like, and in my mind, you know, depression looks like, I don't know, I didn't feel like I fitted into the box of what, you know, depression was.
Yeah.
And then things didn't get any better, and I was like, well, maybe this is what depression looks like for me. That was kind of where it started for me.
That sounds like, it's really hard to accept things like, you know, I'm depressed.
Yeah.
And it sounds like
it is.
The thing that helped you was actually a friend sort of reaching out to you.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's, I used to get really funny about talking to my friends about it, because I'd be like, I don't want to bother, like, they've all got their own stuff going on, I don't want to bother them. Like, I don't want to be that person who is always bringing it down. But that's not it at all. Like, I think what I learned is that your friends love to, they love you for who you are, and they want to help, and they'd probably be more mortified if you hadn't said anything. And if they were to learn that you were battling for so long, and you hadn't reached out to them.
Absolutely.
So, I mean, that's kind of how I look at it. But then in saying that, it's also up to you as a person to take responsibility and accountability for where you're at, you know? Mm. Like, at the end of the day, your friends can't help you make it a decision to change what's happening. Your parents can't do it. That's really down to you.
Mm.
And I guess where your friends and where community does help is to get you to a point where you can make that decision.
Mm. I really like that distinction. It's like you've got to own what's happening to you, but you can still draw on that support from your friends and community to help you facilitate doing that.
Absolutely.
Getting help.
Yeah, because I mean, like I said, I think, you know, the older you get, the more you become aware of things, you realise that people are all fighting their own battles.
Mm.
And something which might seem trivial to you is actually a really big deal to someone else.
Mm.
And so I've certainly learned you just got to walk a lot more softly and just be a lot more sensitive and less judgmental.
Yeah.
Because, yeah. And I'm still learning that.
Yeah.
And I still have, you know, when you think you've got a situation or a person kind of, this is what they're about, you see something which flips your perception on its head, and you're like, I feel really bad for thinking that way. Like, how could I think that way? But you know, that's what life is, and you learn and you keep going, and you just try and be the best person. You just try and be a good person.
I think that's a good way to put it. You know, you can't change the past.
I think it's quite hard to see the forest from the tree sometimes. You know, you get so fixed on an outcome, and even if you don't reach that outcome, you forget to see, you forget to appreciate the process and the small victories you had along the way.
Mm.
And you know, to actually take the positives out of it, because there's always positives. There's always positives out of any situation.
When you first started to experience that struggle, you didn't talk about it. You white knuckled it.
Yeah.
And why do you think?
Why did I do that?
Yeah. Why do you think you did that? Yeah.
So, I think initially for me, I was operating in an environment, in a sporting environment, which was focused on high performance.
Mm.
And the people I was surrounding myself with, the people I trained with, the people who I was with on a day-to-day basis, there's no real room for empathy because everyone else is so focused on what they're trying to do, and they're trying to get to a goal. And not saying they're not empathetic people, but just in that environment, there's little room for empathy.
Yeah.
To be empathetic, you'd have to draw energy from somewhere else. And that would, that would detract from their own personal performance.
It sounds like
it's an interesting construct, and it's I don't really. I mean, in all fairness, I think I was probably looking for support in just the wrong places.
Mm. I think that's a really good thing to talk about, because it's almost like a social cultural thing that's quite present in sport. It's competitive nature, but I think it's present in the wider world as well, in jobs we do and relationships we have and all these different aspects. So where do you think that comes from, getting deeper, that some of those ideas around success and bottling up emotions? Yeah, what do you think that's all about?
I think in New Zealand in particular, I think there's just an aversion around femininity. And what that means and how it's perceived. I think there's a perception that, feminine traits, being open and expressive and empathetic, are viewed as undesirable or like as weakness. I'm not sure whether guys feel they might be viewed less desirably if they express those feminine traits. I'm not sure what it is, but I imagine that, maybe it has something to do with it.
Yeah, well, I think it's interesting talking to you, because you were someone who went on The Bachelor, a show that's all about desirability. But really what you seem to be saying is that's not how you want to be seen as desirable, as someone, I guess maybe portrayed on that show.
I'm uncomfortable with being portrayed as someone who's physically desirable, as opposed to like emotionally desirable, if that makes sense. Like, I'd rather be perceived as desirable because I am open, I can communicate, I can be expressive, I'm not afraid of talking about my feelings and important things. I think I'd feel way more comfortable if I was portrayed as desirable because of those things, as opposed to here's a guy who's got, like short hair, white teeth, and is clean shaven. That's what desirable looks like. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. Yeah. I think a lot of men out there has some understanding that being empathic and talking about their feelings would be helpful to them, but they're scared of being undesirable, and maybe some women too have this idea of what a desirable man is, and that maybe that stoic ideal. I think it's changing though.
I'd like to think it's changing as well. I think, how do you, if someone's desirable male is like a quintessential Kiwi bloke who plays rugby, and is gruff and says about four words, in a sentence, kind of who are we to tell them that that's not what desirable is? And I find myself thinking about that, because here I am saying, here we are saying, like, that's, whilst it might be desirable, it's probably not helpful.
I think it's a hard line to toe, because I think there's some traits of, maybe you could call it masculinity, that are really healthy and positive, being a good provider, although not to an extreme where you think I have to be a provider, and maybe my female partner can't provide. I think, being physically strong can be really helpful.
That provides security, right? There are a lot of positives.
It seems to be that, the key is maybe some balance between, some of those, what are seen as masculine qualities, and what you're saying is to also embrace more feminine quality?
Absolutely, yeah. And I guess, you know, drawing on, you know, a quality which might be seen as masculine would be, you know, brave and courageous, taking those and actually reaching out to that person and showing your vulnerabilities and being brave. So it's kind of like, you know, that's possibly where masculinity and femininity kind of combine, is that you're being courageous and showing your vulnerabilities to that person, you know, by expressing, you know, support and compassion.
Even think about the words masculine and feminine. They're useful words to think about, but it's almost like those are removed and you can just be yourself.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think that's hugely liberating.
You know, we live in a world where we're told, you know, what we should be doing, like what we should look like, what we should feel, and then, you know, we don't always identify with those sorts of things because we are all different, you know. And
instead we look around like what are other people doing and wearing and saying and acting like.
Yeah. And I mean, social media is massive that as well, you know, like you have instant gratification or instant criticism on something, you know, and that's a whole different construct, which our generation have to deal with. But the biggest realization I had, which helped me move on, was realizing that a situation got the better of me. And being okay with that, you know, like being able to admit that I was in a situation and yeah, it broke me. But you know, I came through the other side and I'm a stronger person for it. Almost to the point where I say it was the making of, I feel like it's had a lot to do with the making of me, you know, like I grew a lot in such a short space, and I feel like I'm a different person now than what I was before I went through that experience. For the better.
In any like hero story that we've read growing up, usually there's a huge barrier that the hero faces that completely derails them.
Yeah.
And then they come back from it, and that builds resilience and builds, you know, passion and motivation.
Yeah.
That'll then permeate through the entire life.
Whilst it was a dream for me to go to an Olympics, my Olympics wasn't actually going to the event. It was, you know, coming through that experience.
Sounds like to me you're like trying to change the way we view success. You're saying like, you know, success
absolutely
is the little things.
Yes,
having a baby is. Having a good relationship.
Yes, it is.
Just getting out of bed.
It is. And I mean, like, for me, I'm really fortunate that I work in sport. I love that I work in sport. And I, because I feel like for me that's the easiest way I can put a spin on it, you know, like sports are often they in the past have been really outcome driven, and it's where I can flip that and say, no, it's not. This is about the process. This is about, you know, sport is there to teach you life lessons. And, you know, I'm teaching these lessons through the vehicle of through the vehicle of sport. I'm teaching you work ethic. I'm teaching you compassion. I'm teaching you, you know, sportsmanship, conduct. I'm teaching you how to be honest. I'm teaching you all these things through working hard and training and racing. And yeah, just to change the perception of what performance is for my guys.
So I've got one more question. This is the final segment of the show. It's called The Thread.
The thread.
Yeah. Yeah, right. There's a thread of questions running through this entire season from each interviewee.
Yep.
So you'll get to ask the next interviewer a question too. But the last interview was a guy called Harlem Ratapu from Gizzy. He's a beekeeper and spear fisherman, and he likes to go deep.
Right.
And he asked you, Zac, in essence, who are you?
Great question. I feel like I'm someone who's confident, and I feel like if I have to expose myself and put my vulnerabilities out there in order to help other people, then I think I'm really, I feel obligated to, I actually feel like I have an obligation to do that. I feel like I have a responsibility.
Sitting here, I think you're courageous. I think you're living that, and you know, you're a great role model for the people out there, Zac. So.
Yeah, I appreciate it, Sam. Thanks, mate. I really appreciate that, especially, I mean, yeah, coming from someone who, again, has explored their own vulnerabilities and is very authentic to their purpose, that means a lot, mate. So, yeah, thanks for having me.
Thank you. Is anybody out there?